good morning and welcome to First Church Unitarian in Littleton on this absolutely perfect May morning. We are so lucky. So this is a busy day, a lot going on. First of all, I'm supposed to introduce myself, sorry. I'm Martha Childs. I am a member of the Standing Committee. And I want to welcome everybody here and at home. If you're watching us from home, it's too bad you missed the Maypole. But other than that, it'll be wonderful. They will be in the Maypole. Okay, good, good. Somehow, magically, virtually, you'll be in the Maypole. I wanted to call your attention to a few of the things happening today, but first, in your community matters, I noticed there was a request for UU-ish books for a tiny library. I don't know if everyone's aware, there's a tiny library out in front of the church, and I just filled it up this morning, and we're running low on books. So if you feel inclined to do a little house cleaning and have some excellent books, we could certainly use them. Today, several things going on. First of all, there is a budget meeting at 11:30. So after you go and get your coffee and have a little fellowship, at 11:30, the budget meeting will start. For those at home, you'll use the usual Zoom link. The budget meeting will not be on YouTube. It's only on the Zoom link, which is the regular one that you use, like right now. Very important meeting. And that's in preparation for our annual meeting, which comes up in a couple of weeks. And so I think maybe that's it. We will proceed after I'm done with the reading of the warrant. Enjoy this lovely day.
Hi, I'm Ann Donald, your clerk. First, the voting list is now available on our website as well as posted at the church. I am notifying you, the members of First Church Unitarian, that you are lawfully entitled to vote in its affairs, to meet in person in the sanctuary, or on a Zoom call. The link will be provided after church services on May 21st at 11:30 a.m. following the Sunday service, and a brief social time to act on the following articles. First, to review and accept the members' minutes from the October 23, 2022 warranted meeting. Second, to hear and act upon the 2022 to 2023 annual report. Third, to elect officers of First Church Unitarian and nominating committee members. Fourth, to act upon the proposed budget for July 2023 through June 2024. Fifth, to authorize the treasurer to borrow money on behalf of the church. Sixth, to transact any other business that may lawfully come before said meeting. Thank you. First.
I carried my fear of the world to my children, but they refused it. I carried my fear of the world on my chest, where I once carried my children, where some nights it slept as newborns sleep, where it purred, but mostly growled. I carried my fear of the world and apprenticed myself to the fear. I carried my fear of the world as if it could protect me from the world. I carried my fear of the world to my children and laid it down at their feet. A kill, a gift. I carried my fear of the world to my children, but they refused it. The words of Maggie Smith. Let us worship. I'd like to invite Natalie to light our chalice this morning. And as Natalie lights our chalice, please join me in saying the words of our covenant. Love is the spirit of this church, and service its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Good morning. Welcome to First Church Unitarian here in Littleton, Massachusetts. My name is Lara Hoke, pronouns she, her, and I'm so happy and glad and lucky to be the minister serving this incredible congregation. If you're here with us this morning in the pews for the first time, we welcome you and hope that you can stay with us after the service for fellowship and coffee and the vestry. You can just follow us in there. If you are new with us this morning online, we welcome you and hope that if you haven't already done so, you'll visit our website, fculittle.org, and there you can find lots of information about us and also find ways to contact us if you wish. But it is, as Martha said, a gorgeous morning. So happy to be here. Great luck for the Maypole later in the service. Today we are having a service thinking about some of the messages within the 2010s. We've been doing a series on spiritual messages tucked within the decades, starting with the 50s back in October, and finally today we're coming up to the present. So it is the last of this series. And I think you will enjoy beginning to think about what we learned from the decade services and how it can help us move forward. So we'll start to do that today too. All right, so today, again, music from the 2010s, which is half the fun. And our first song is Let It Go. So I invite you to rise in body or spirit, and the lyrics are on the screen as well as in your insert.
Thank you.
This morning we have a reading from a 2019 article from BuzzFeed by Katherine Miller called "The 2010s Broke Our Sense of Time." This long and wearying decade is coming to a close, even if there's no sense of an ending. People are always saying stuff like, "Time has melted, my brain has melted." I can't remember if that was 2 weeks ago, or 2 months ago, or 2 years ago. What a year this week has been. The touch and taste of the 2010s was non-linear acceleration, always moving, always faster, but torn this way and that way, pushed forward and pulled back. The 2000s, the aughts, were a bad decade, full of terrorism, financial ruin, and war. The 2010s were different, somehow more disorienting, though, full of molten anxiety, racism, and moral horrors. Maybe there's a reason for the disorientation. Life had run on a certain rhythm of time and logic, and now that has disappeared until you can barely remember what time it is. "Why men are wearing watches that don't tell time," read a Wall Street Journal headline a few years ago. Like a riddle. "Some men," the journal reported, "buy vintage mechanical watches but never get them serviced or repaired, nor even wind them. They simply leave the watches dead." Now, stories like this can't apply to too many people, but even if it's just one man, somewhere right now, he walks this earth with a beautiful broken watch. We all know what's changed, what's really happened in the 2010s. The internet is no longer a place you go. Who we are on the phone and in the walking world have merged. This is why algorithmic time, times based on algorithms as opposed to chronological time, is so disorienting and why it bends your mind. Everything good, bad, and complicated flows through our phones. The algorithms that are never quite with you in the moment make it so that you can find yourself feeling amazing and awful, exult in and be repelled by life in the space of seconds. The thing you've been waiting for, it's always there, pulling you back under again and again and again. Who can remember anything anymore? nice to have that long line of kids, isn't it? Yeah. It's now a time for our offering. I share words of Kayla Parker. We know that our financial contributions to this congregation come from sacrifice and hard work. We're so grateful for this and commit together to ensure the funds that we gather collectively do greater good for ourselves and for our world than they could have done alone. May there be an offering to sustain and grow the life and mission of this congregation. May we now give in love and in hope. Please join with me in the words of our community response. We are grateful for the opportunity to give and serve, and grateful for the gifts we have received. May this affirm the ministries of our church community, both within and beyond these walls. Most weeks, we have a special time to share our joys and concerns. We call this our Candles of Caring. If you have an important joy or concern that you'd like to share with this beloved community, we ask that you let us know your name and briefly, in a couple of sentences, let us know how we might direct our thoughts or prayers or healing wishes. And raise your hand high enough so that we can see it in the sanctuary, and we'll bring a microphone to you where you are and light a candle up front. If you're with us on Zoom, please use the hand raise function in the reactions area, and we will call on you in turn. Are there any candles of caring this morning? Once again, we have come together in love and trust, sharing those cares dearest to us with this gathered beloved community. Let us now hold in our thoughts and prayers those joys and concerns spoken aloud, as well as those that remain unspoken, as we share together in a time of sacred silence. God blessed be. Ah, yes, the human microphone of the Occupy movement. When you don't have a permit for a microphone and a sound system, the human microphone is what you use. Yes, I do believe that the Occupy movement, which kicked off in September 2011, was really the event that started the cultural decade of the 2010s. Or perhaps you could argue the Occupy movement in the fall of 2011, followed quickly thereafter by the re-election of Barack Obama in 2012. The disdain for the status quo couldn't overcome the power of the status quo. President Obama was first elected in 2008 with a platform of hope and change, and it was a time of feeling that there was some hope for some change. And it was largely the millennials who were new voters who put Obama into office. And yet by late 2011, with mass surveillance and the wars of the 2000s continuing on, with surveillance and drone strikes even escalating, it was clear that there wasn't as much change as some might have hoped for. But it was really economic inequality that was at the heart of the Occupy movement. With the struggles the millennial generation was having entering the world of adulthood, entering the workforce, with less opportunity than their parents had had in many cases, that was what gave birth to the Occupy movement more than anything. Spiritually speaking, Occupy had a prophetic zeal. Voices crying out for justice, telling us that our ways must change. Having spent some time at Occupy Boston myself, I can tell you that it was a complicated movement. Many of the participants were on what you might call the far left of the political spectrum. There were a small handful of folks that might be closer to what you call the far right, interestingly. And of course, there were plenty there who were disgruntled with the status quo, but pretty much up for grabs, politically speaking. In hindsight, perhaps this backdrop led to the strangeness of the 2016 election, at least in part, with what felt like a bigger divide between the sides than ever before. And though the pundits all predicted a Hillary Clinton victory, with hindsight, you can see why Donald Trump, an anti-status quo candidate, won. Well, he won the Electoral College. Clinton won the popular vote. That pattern is familiar. But it was a very, very close election. We were and are divided. Today, I'm going to touch on some of the high and low lights of the 2010s, but with less detail than in previous sermons in this series. In part, I'm not sure enough time has passed to reflect with the full necessary amount of retrospection. And in part, I'm aware that it's too recent to have much of anything by way of nostalgia. But also this morning, I want to begin to spend some time on the point of the decade series beyond the fun we have with the music and so on. I want to think about looking forward with the knowledge of the modern decades in this country, perhaps giving us perspective, perhaps helping us to make educated guesses as we move forward. As the reading I shared earlier pointed out, by the 2010s, most Americans were inextricably linked to the internet and social media. At the start of the 2010s, about 30% of all Americans had a cell phone. By the end of the 2010s, more than 80% of us had a cell phone, most of them smartphones. The internet is part of our life now, an integral part of our life, in ways that most of us never would have imagined when we got onto our big old desktop computers and waded through that strange sounding dial tone to check a couple of emails, to see maybe if a business we were interested in even had a website. As Katherine Miller put it in the article I shared earlier, we all know what's really happened in the 2010s. The internet is no longer a place you go. Who we are on the phone and in the walking world has merged. Case in point, many of you are, of course, participating online, on the internet right now, whether on your cell phone or a laptop, or maybe even some on a desktop, who knows? How many of you have a cell phone with you right now? Show them if you got them.
I have two.
All right, and I have one right here in the pulpit every Sunday. It's a thing, people. We and the internet are almost one. Spiritually speaking, this is complicated, and it will become its own sermon next fall. So stay tuned. In previous decades services, I've been able to talk about music and movie and TV trends, but I'm at a little bit of a loss today. Partly, what trends, what music trends? The music scene is more diverse than ever, and mostly that's a great thing. But it does mean that we have fewer shared cultural touchstones than we once did. As for movies, it's hard to believe that brick and mortar movie theaters are going to survive much longer. Most of us are watching movies at home. We're streaming them through the internet onto our televisions, along with various TV series. And we watch them when we watch them. Again, that sense of time has been messed with to some extent. There's much less asking a friend, did you see so-and-so a movie yet? Because when you watch a movie, doesn't really match up that closely to its release date, for the most part. And television shows, forget it. With streaming shows and on-demand and binging shows, everyone is on their own timeline. So you might be watching the same show that your best friend watched, but maybe you're binging it 3 years after your best friend stopped watching it. Again, chronological time just isn't what it used to be. Spiritually thinking, it's though we're all living in eternal time with no clear beginning and no clear end. Time just is. In previous decade services, I've been able to talk about fashions and fads, but I'm not sure enough time has passed for me to really spot them. To my eyes, you all still look normal. I do note that fidget spinners became a thing in the 2010s, for people of all ages, really, and it's a small wonder that we're feeling more fidgety, spending less time out in the analog world moving. It's a reminder there's that profound mind-body-spirit connection. And as much as the modern world makes it possible for many of us to live with minimal body movement, the body still cries out to be integrated into our lives. On the major events side of things, there's so much to say about the 2010s. There were more mass shootings in the 2010s than I can begin to go into. There were more extreme weather events, fueled in part by climate change, than I can go into. There were more shootings of unarmed Black people, often at the hands of law enforcement, than I can go into. But it was a lot, the 2010s. It has had an apocalyptic feel, as did the decade before it. The seemingly never-ending footprint of September 11th carried on into the 2010s, of course. U.S. Navy SEALs killed Osama bin Laden, the leader of Al-Qaeda, the apparent mastermind behind 9/11, in 2011. In 2013, Edward Snowden leaked some highly classified documents from the NSA, letting Americans know that, yes, there was a vast surveillance, vast and unwarranted, literally unwarranted surveillance and intrusion into privacy by the United States government, all justified by the Patriot Act and other unfortunate responses to 9/11. And yet, in spite of all the mass surveillance, terrorist acts can still happen. We all remember the Boston Marathon of 2013 with the two bombs near the finish line. Spiritually, it feels like God is indeed watching our every move, seeing our thoughts even, but not intervening. What do you even do with that much knowledge of human hearts and minds if you're not going to do anything with it? What comes of it all? There were other domestic issues happening, of course. Three Black female activists started using the hashtag Black Lives Matter in 2013 after George Zimmerman was acquitted in spite of shooting and killing the unarmed Trayvon Martin. The Black Lives Matter movement really took on steam in 2014, and you might remember that the Black Lives Matter movement was quite controversial in its earlier years. Now, almost a decade later, most people of conscience have embraced it to varying degrees. The never-ending stream of live cell phone recordings and police camera recordings of the horrors eventually were too much to be ignored. Those with eyes to see and ears to hear did see and listen. Convictions of law enforcement in these cases are finally just starting to happen sometimes. Change is beginning to come. Activism can create change, even if it does take time. Another case in point, the 2013 Defense of Marriage Act was struck down by the Supreme Court. In 2015, with the Supreme Court case Obergefell versus Hodges, same-sex marriage was legalized nationwide. Yes, many of us same-sex couples who had been legally married in Massachusetts for years, more than a decade even in some cases, could finally file federal taxes together, were finally entitled to the benefits that come with legal marriage, most of which are federal. On the other side, though, of the LGBTQ plus struggles, our transgender siblings were facing backlash from the increasing awareness of their existence. There were battles over using the bathrooms that matched gender identity. The Trump administration also banned or reinstated a ban on transgender citizens serving in the military. The struggle to have all of society recognize the inherent worth and dignity of transgender and non-binary people just as they are, just as they are meant to be, continues. The hashtag MeToo movement took off in 2017 after Hollywood producer Harvey Weinstein's sexual harassment, assaults, and more came to light, followed by the actions of other perpetrators coming to light and being exposed. And we began to realize that the majority of those who are identified as female at birth could participate in the hashtag MeToo movement, since virtually all of those people identified as female at birth have dealt with harassment or assault or more. Given that these incidents have been happening forever, in a way it's astounding that a movement didn't take shape until 2017. Psalm 13 comes to mind. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? If the Black Lives Matter movement hadn't drawn you in before, in 2017, the white supremacist rally in Charlottesville, Virginia, which led to 3 deaths, might have done it. A deeper discussion about racism in the 21st century really was beginning in this country. It continues as we begin to tackle the profound and insidious nature of white supremacy culture in this nation. It is, along with a fight against fascism, a fight for the very soul of this nation. Can we be saved? When did the cultural 2010s end and the cultural 2020s begin? I think you'd have to say it was the COVID-19 pandemic, starting in early 2020, followed quickly thereafter by the election of Joe Biden to be president in 2020 and the election of Kamala Harris to be vice president, becoming the first woman and the first person of color to serve in that role. One could argue that the January 6, 2021 storming of the US Capitol by rioters who were interrupting the Electoral College certification of Biden and Harris was an attempt to keep the 2020s from beginning, but chronological time hasn't been quite that destroyed yet. You can't stop it from happening, thankfully. Not yet. May we keep that so. Biden, of course, did eventually get certified and become the 46th president of the United States in 2021. It's only 2023 now, and I can't say much given the coming elections and the fact that Biden is apparently running again, and so for that matter, is Trump. So, we shall see. We shall see. There is work to be done, as Cindy said last week. What can we say about the future based on the patterns we've noted from the decade's services? A few things I'll say that came to mind right away for me. Obviously, technology plays an ongoing and increasingly profound role in our lives. Short of an actual apocalypse, it's hard to imagine that that won't continue to be true. It feels like the fight for liberation of all people will continue, and it does feel, in many ways, like this grand battle of good versus evil. It feels that way to me more now than it ever did. And it feels like the time to take a stand for the good has never been more pressing, with fascism rearing its head and with catastrophic climate change still upon us. The pandemic sent us all into literal survival mode for a few years, but we can't linger there. The triumph of good over evil requires us to get back to it, and soon. Compared to where we started on this journey, thinking back to the cultural 1950s, we have come a long way. We have. It's important to remember that. In addition to all of the oppressed groups who have come a long way in this time, we have come a long way in part simply by being able to have the discussions openly. In the 1950s, still waters ran deep. There was fear, great fear, for good reason in many cases, of speaking your truth, of talking about the big issues. Today, that running water is flowing swiftly and right at the surface. The problems sometimes are still there, but increasingly, things are out in the open where we can see them and deal with them. And that gives me hope for good over evil. The last thing I'll say today is that it's clear that U.S. society has more diversity than ever, and diversity is beautiful. How do we celebrate diversity, yet also find ways to have community beyond and across diversity? That feels like a challenge for the rest of the 21st century. Next week, we'll continue to think a bit about the implications of our timeline review this church year, and I hope you will join me in mulling it over. As I look back, it gives me courage and faith that we can move forward, because it is undeniably true, as Martin Luther King Jr. said, that the moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends toward justice. May it be so. Blessed be, and amen. And now, we get to engage our bodies in this mind-body-spirit connection. We're gonna go outside and dance around the maypole, and we'll sing our closing song out there, so take that lyrics insert with you so you can join along in singing at the end. So please join me in going outside.
Okay. Is it on?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Oh. Okay. Sorry. Hold on.
Speak into the microphone.
And maybe that
one strand. Wait. So what I'm gonna do?
So go back and check again, Jim.
Michael, look.
Yeah, don't go too far. You'll break it. Why? Say hi to everybody at home.
We have more ribbons for anybody who's interested. Things in, we're just not necessarily bringing you along, but we are supporting. So this is what you need to do. You need to spread out a little.
This way.
And then you need to
turn right.
So you're facing each other.
Wait.
Everyone.
Every other person. Say one, say two. One, two. One.
Are we weaving?
Left hand is up, with the right hand is down.
Yes.
Are we weaving?
Left hand.
Okay, weave in and out, everybody. Weave in and out. It doesn't matter. Be flexible.
Oh.
Be flexible. Be flexible. Keep moving. Keep moving one way or the other. Just move. Move, move, move.
Up and down.
Thank you.
I gotta get on the other side. For everyone at home, we're going to close down the trip now. We're going to break here. We're going to leave Zoom up. Thank you. Everybody, join us on this same bat time, same bat station on Zoom, not YouTube, for the budget review. Thank you.